Welcome to Gospel Tangents, the best source for Mormon history, science, and theology. I'm Rick Bennett. I'm excited to continue our conversation with Dr. Amanda Hendricks-Komodo. She's the author of Imperial Zions, and you could win a free copy of this book if you win our contest. Go to gospeltangents.com/contest, and you could win this free autographed copy from Amanda. In our next conversation, we're going to talk about Native American racism. So it's another tough topic. You won't want to miss it. Check it out.
Well, you don't only concentrate on Polynesians. You talk about...
Yeah.
I talked to Matt Harris. We hate to use the word Lamanites, but that's the term that they were called, or Native Americans. Let's talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah. So I was interested... I mean, one of the things that sort of animates the book is I'm interested in how white Mormons are forming their family structures at the same moment that they're involved in these imperial colonizing, I don't want to say schemes, but schemes. and I was interested to see sort of what happened when you looked at both Mormons in Polynesia and abroad, and then how that related to what was going on. This chapter, so I'm from southeastern Idaho. I grew up next to Fort Hall, which is where the Shoshone-Bannock Reservation is. I am not Native American, but my grandmother's first husband was Shoshone.
Oh.
And then she divorced him and married my grandfather. And so I have many great aunts and uncles and cousins who are Shoshone-Bannock. My sister is married to a Shoshone-Bannock man. They haven't enrolled my niece yet, but that is one of the things that they plan to do. And so I know a lot of Shoshone-Bannock people. Despite that, I knew very little about the history when I began this book. I grew up in Wapello, which is a small place outside, an unincorporated place outside of Blackfoot. And we did Idaho history, but none of it, we never really talked much about Native Americans. We learned about the Nez Perce and Chief Joseph and his famous speech. We learned a little bit about the Shoshone-Bannock and visited the Fort Hall replica in Pocatello, but nothing about the massacre that had occurred. And so when I was doing the research, it was really learning about where I grew up as well as about sort of how white Latter-day Saints had interacted with Native people. And I focused on the Shoshone partially because those were the stories that I was closest to.
Were you near the Bear River Massacre site? I'm trying to, because that's right by Preston, Idaho.
Yeah, so I've been there. It's about an hour-ish from my hometown.
Okay.
And I hadn't heard of that until I was a grad student, actually.
Okay.
I later realized that I had heard... So there are, like, stories that you hear growing up around southeast Idaho. And what I've realized now is that some of them, they're like a mix of history and folklore and Native folklore that have all sort of been put together. One story that my stepdad told me was, and he was LDS, Jack Mormon. His mom and dad went through the temple for the first time when they were like 70-something.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But they had been Mormon their whole life. They just, you know, like many Jack Mormons, didn't see the point in going until they were in their 70s. But he had told me that the Snake River there were souls of Indian children there, and that what had happened was they had been drowned by their mothers as their mothers were escaping a massacre. And he wasn't really specific, an act of violence. And that the souls of the Indian babies were murdered and angry. And therefore, if you went and played too close to the river, they would pull you under. And that story always stuck with me. And I think there's a story in the Bear River Massacre about a Native woman who did drown her child because her choice was between being discovered because the baby was crying and then both of them dying, or letting the baby go into the water. And so the story that is told is that she let the baby go. And I think Darren Perry, who wrote a book on the Bear River Massacre, mm-hmm. and is Northwestern Shoshone himself, talks about that story. And so I think like part of the story that my stepfather was telling was a half remembered sort of memory of that. There's also, I found out later, stories among the Shoshone of a creature that hides in the lakes and mimics baby's cries and pulls people down. I think it's partially that woven in. And then some guilt, and then honestly, probably some like horror stories are always a little bit about the thrill. So that was probably mixed into a story as well. But it's these settler stories that are sort of half remembered and then are told. But the history behind what's going on is never sort of spoken about. And so I started reinterpreting some of the stuff that I had been told as a kid after I began researching the Bear River Massacre and the Shoshone and their early interactions with Native Americans. And then the Shoshone, as you know, Northwestern Shoshone end up converting to Mormonism.
Right.
The Shoshone Bannock do not. They are largely Episcopalian, Catholic, not Mormon. And there's some tension, if you talk with different people, between the Northwestern Shoshone and the Shoshone Bannock.
Oh, you know, so I'm trying to remember, so you grew up in Blackfoot, and I always thought that was the strangest name, but yes, there are Blackfoot Indians.
That, so in fourth grade, Miss Cloris Brown, or Mrs. Cloris Brown, cast me as the narrator and made me and a girl named Stephanie Reeder tell the story of how Blackfoot got its name.
Okay.
It's not connected to the Blackfeet Indians. I do not remember the story that Stephanie had to tell, but I remember the one that she made me memorize. And the story that she made me memorize is that there had been like a forest fire before the pioneers came through. And the story is that when they walked through, their feet got black from the ash, and that's why they named it Blackfoot. That does not sound like a true story to me, but that is the story that I was told in fourth grade. But okay, it's not named after the Blackfoot Indians or Blackfeet Indians. It, whether they're called Blackfoot or Blackfeet depends on what side of the U.S.-Canadian border you're on.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Are they Shoshone as well, or are they?
No, they're a separate group. Okay. Yeah. Although they're related as like Plains Indians, but they're not Shoshone at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So there's some tension there, I think, although it's probably, I won't speak for anybody, you can ask my brother-in-law one day whether or not it's dissipating,
the tensions between the Northwest
and then the Northwestern Shoshone set up their own Native Mormon town in northern Utah, very near the Idaho border, called Washakie.
Yeah.
And it ends up...
Isn't it Washakie?
Sure.
I think Lindsay Hanson Park says, most of us say Washakie, but it's supposed to be Washakie, I think.
Okay. I will trust Lindsay. She's very smart. Yeah, so they end up setting up their own town. It's an interesting place. I have not yet visited. I actually asked Darren what he thought if I would go visit, and he warned me that it is now, I think, owned by fundamentalists. And Darren suggested I not go, so I followed his advice.
Wow.
But they had their own ward, and if you ask Darren, he has like a map. It's really interesting. I think there was a horse racing track, which was very popular among the Shoshone, rodeos and horse racing and just various equestrian sports, I think have long been a part of Shoshone culture. In Blackfoot, every year we have what we call the Indian relay races, but there's also rodeos and actually my great uncles, the Shoshone great uncles, Buster and Frenchie, they, when they were young men, rode in rodeos. And if you do like their search their name in the newspapers, that's what comes up is like them riding in a rodeo, busting a bronco. And they saw it as like, that's what they did as Shoshone men. And so they really loved it. And I think that's part of what's going on there too. But much like the Native Hawaiians, that town allows them to create a Native space and a community and to reconnect. And then they have absolutely beautiful stories about having visions of the people who died from the Bear River Massacre, and then saying their names in the temple and being able to sort of bind their families together that way after the Bear River Massacre has torn them apart, and colonization. It's not just the Bear River Massacre. But I think, and Darren could speak to this more powerfully, but the church becomes a way for them to reclaim something that they felt they had lost. If you ask the Shoshone Bannock, as non-Mormons, they have they're not all non-Mormon, obviously. There are Shoshone Bannock Mormons. But for those who are non-Mormon, they have a very different take on what the church means for the Shoshone. But for Shoshone Mormons, I think it becomes a way to reassert a Shoshone identity.
Oh, very interesting. So what else do we have as far as the West that you would like to talk about in your book? Because we've talked about the Pacific Islanders, we've talked about the Native Americans. What else can we talk about there?
That's a huge question. I mean, I think one of the things that's interesting about Latter-day Saints in the West is, so I am a historian of family and sexuality, and so I'm always interested in how Mormons both become the subjects of attempts to reform their sexuality, but they are also at the same time trying to reform Shoshone families and to cause them to act more like white Latter-day Saints. There's lots of interesting conversations I've seen these in Relief Society minutes, although I'd have to find you a citation, about like women carrying their children in cradle boards and that being inappropriate, which is, the reason I find that so interesting is Latter-day Saints are also having people critiquing the way that they're raising their children. And then, not surprisingly, because they're human, they turn right around and critique the way other people are raising their children. But that's really what I find fascinating, is like those everyday interactions and the way that those take place among white Latter-day Saints and Native Americans. Sometimes those relationships can be violent. Sometimes they can be very intimate. One family story that I had heard that I had always assumed was not true and still could not be true, but there's more evidence now that it might be. In one of my family histories, there was a story of a white woman who had a baby, and a Native man approached her and asked for her to care for his child because his wife had just died and the baby needed breast milk. And she initially hesitated, but eventually decided to raise the child. She talks about bathing it. She talks about nursing it. And then it ended up getting sick and died when the baby was two. And I had always assumed that that story wasn't true. But then when I looked at the Springville, Utah cemetery records, there was a listing for this child. There's not actually a grave. It's like on a list of the pioneers, or at least I haven't found the grave yet. And so I was surprised to find out that some of the stories that I assumed were absolutely not true might actually have like at least a kernel of truth behind them. But those are sorts of the things that I find really interesting, is the ways that individual families navigated that. One of the stories I found after I finished my dissertation was the story of Johnny Garr, who's a mixed-race man. He is born to a Shoshone woman. The Shoshone woman eventually asks his white father to care for him. He gets married to a white woman. This is in the Cache Valley, and around the turn of the century, so around 1900. He ends up dying. The white father then cares for his grandchildren and then his daughter-in-law. And then when he dies, the family, his siblings, challenge his daughter-in-law in court, saying that her children are bastards, that they can't inherit. And it was fascinating to see in the probate records, this little teeny community in Cache Valley fight it out, like, can Native children be the legitimate heirs of white men? They're the son of one of John T. Garr, who's the father's, the son of one of his siblings, admits on the stand, like, my mom didn't like an Indian having our last name. And yet the judge eventually finds, the Utah Supreme Court finds, for the children. And so the children, their family members try to disinherit them, but eventually Utah decides that these children are the legitimate heirs of their grandfather and should get the money. And so it's just fascinating to watch people try to sort of navigate this world that they've created.
Yeah. Well, and you know, racism is a tough a tough topic.
If it wasn't, we would have solved it by now.
So, I mean, what are some of the takeaways we could do? Because your book does dive into, you know, because we always think about black-white racism.
Yeah.
But we don't think about Native American racism. We don't think about Polynesian racism. What are some lessons we could learn here?
I think, well, so I don't, I will tell you what I think. I don't remember if I say these explicitly in the book, and perhaps I don't. I think the first step is to tell a more honest recounting of our history, because if we, you can't address problems that you don't know exist. And so I think the first step is knowing the history, and then the second step is recognizing the ramifications of those histories. So the Shoshone-Bannock Nation obviously still exists, and they still experience a lot of racism. I remember, and she has passed away now, so she can't, well, maybe she can do something about me telling the story, but my Mormon grandmother was very much a person of her time who wanted to accept everybody, but sometimes things would come out of her mouth, right, that were just like, oh my gosh, grandma. And one of the things she would talk about, because she had grown up next to the reservation, was drunk Indians all the time. It was like, oh, there's a drunk Indian over there. And she would say this knowing that I had Native family members. And so I think recognizing that that racism continues is really important. But then I think there's a way in which occasionally we need to put our money where our mouth is. When I go to Pocatello, will often stay at the casino because that money goes into the hands of the Shoshone-Bannock Nation. And so I think we can read that history, we can learn about that history all that we want, but at some point it's about frequenting Native hotels, buying Native goods, recognizing Native sovereignty. Often that takes place at a court level, but I do think there are ways that we can do that within our everyday lives. Whether that be like, I remember when I went during COVID, the Shoshone-Bannock Nation had a sign about their sovereignty saying like, we are a separate nation and we have declared that you're going to wear a mask. And you still see white people walking in without a mask. And when I go to Tahiti, for example, I follow the customs rules. And people living in Southeast Idaho need to, and in Utah, need to follow the rules when they go to reservations. But I think it starts with visiting reservations, visiting those communities, buying from them, going to the hotels, visiting the restaurants. One of my family members, I'm going to call her an aunt, but I'm not exactly sure if she's a cousin or an aunt, owns, she's Shoshone, she owns a vending machine that sells earrings in the Fort Hall gas station. You can visit her vending machine, and that is hands in the pocket of a Native woman who is selling her artwork and deserves to be supported. So I think one way is just buying Native goods. And I know that's, I don't say that in the book per se, but I think that's one of the ways to start addressing these histories in really tangible ways. I think the other way that we need to do it is not just learning about these stories ourselves, but telling them to our children, and making sure that they can name the indigenous people whose land upon they live, and that they know the stories.
I've noticed that we do that at like MHA.
Yeah.
We remember this land as former, I'm not saying it the right way, but former Indian land, basically.
Well, and that's actually started to be criticized as not going far enough, and the emphasis has been, and what am I going to do to address that? And so that's what I've started to try to do, is I'll acknowledge the land, I'll talk about how I am a part of this history, And then I will talk about sort of, I will try to do stuff as well to support. So I think that's part of it. It's not just like acknowledging, it's an action forward. But the acknowledging is important too, because that's how people learn and first hear of it. And then Hawaii is a really sticky, what's the saying, sticky kettle of fish? I don't know.
can of worms.
Yeah. I mean, I think there is a Native Hawaiian sovereignty movement. And I think the first thing that people need to do who are Americans is to learn about the history of Hawaii. That the Queen of Hawaii, Lulikoani, was illegally deposed. That we annexed Hawaii. That when it was bombed during World War II, it was not a state. It was a foreign territorial holding. And then I think the next part is to listen to Native Hawaiians and to just be up on the politics. Don't visit places that you've been asked not to visit. To buy Native Hawaiian and Polynesian books and to support those communities. I think it all just begins with support, visit, and listening. But it's not something I'm perfect at either.
Yeah. Well, very good. Well, we're going to be giving away a autographed copy of Imperial Zions. So go to gospeltangents.com/contest. You can win a copy here, autographed copy.
I hope you enjoyed our conversation with Dr. Amanda Hendricks-Komodo. In our next conversation, we're going to switch gears and we're going to talk about abortion in the 19th century.
One of the things that really frustrated me was when I heard not just Mormon scholars, but people within Idaho and Utah talk about birth control, the history of abortion and sexuality. It was completely ahistorical and completely detached from the scholarship that had been happening from the 1970s on.
Thanks for listening, and I hope you to continue to enjoy Gospel Tangents. Consider becoming a Patreon or go to gospeltangents.com/shop, and you can get a cool tie, a hat, or even a nice mug. You can also get a sweatshirt, so check it out at gospeltangents.com/shop.